do you reckon, left or right? Do a UE?
Yeah.
I mean, I can do it.
Possible.
Yeah, fuck it. Okay. It doesn't say no U-turn anywhere, so.
Nah, we're legal here.
Is that red or green? What does that mean? That sort of yellow.
It's red.
But what's that line mean? Fucking hell. Not being from a classical music family probably works to my advantage. I've had to go out and find things that I was not necessarily brought up on. You hear like Tory stories of people being brought up in like boogie and disco families, for example, people who've like, they know their, you know, the entire discography of Motown or whatever. For me, I learned everything I know from dance music via my own quest to find more and more and more. So yeah, I suppose to my advantage in the sense that I've not been angled in any way. I've just sort of treading my own path. First time I ever heard electronic music was the Pet Shop Boys used to do a show on Radio 1 once a month on a Sunday night, and they were playing what I now know to be electronic music. I didn't know at the time. And I was well into wrestling. I was about 10, 11 years old. And I remember they played Felix, Don't You Want Me. I remember hearing that and thinking, fuck, what is that? Because I'd never heard anything like it before, never ever. This is like 1990. Like tape deck with two tape players in that you could record. So I record the radio. And then that Felix, Don't You Want Me became my wrestling walk-on music. So I would walk, and I had in my bedroom, I had a wrestling ring, like the ropes painted on all around the walls of my bedroom. So my bedroom was like a wrestling ring. And so I'd walk in my pants. Like wrestling a pillow, which basically turned out to be a massive gay anthem. So there's a 10-year-old walking into his bedroom in his pants to a gay anthem. But yeah, that was my first sort of introduction to electronic music. And then, yeah, my early digging days were like older brothers having decks, me going around their house, playing that hardcore and jungle and stuff like that. And it all came from there, really, just this kind of thirst for knowledge and trudging down to Bristol on a Saturday morning and picking up records from Replay or Time Is Right or Bang Bang. Yeah, I still look back fondly on those days because it doesn't really exist like that anymore, sadly. I mean, digging for me is something I still do every single day. And if I'm not digging, I'm making edits of records that I found. I don't really do promos. I don't really play. I know the promo companies will hate this, but I don't really listen to them. Unless it's a demo I'm sent, then I listen to it. But if it's a promo, everyone else has got them anyway, so what's the point? I want to be playing music that no one else plays, do you know what I mean? So yeah, I try and recreate that record shop culture I try and recreate that record shop culture with edits and stuff, basically.
Here I am.
There's nowhere I want to live in the world other than Bristol, and it's mainly down to the atmosphere in the city and the way people are. It's pretty much the most friendly place you'll ever go. And it's kind of, for me, growing up there, although I didn't actually grow up there, I didn't move there till I was 16. I grew up somewhere just outside of, oh, that sounds good, doesn't it? I grew up just outside of Bristol, a place called Wootton-on-the-Edge, which is kind of like a small town, like 20 miles from Bristol. But going into Bristol was just like, wow, thing, and you're going to these nightclubs and you're seeing, like, you know, a whole plethora of techno DJs from like Daz Sawn to Colin Favour to Colin Dale to Horton to Carl Cox, and then like UK house DJs like your Judge Jules's back in the day, and all these different people, John Please Women, John De Silva, etc. And then also drum and bass angle, so like growing up around Ronnie Size and Dying Crust and all these guys who are now my mates, and just having this around you, this consistent flow of what I think is amazing talent and amazing DJs being brought to what is an amazing nightclub and still is to this day, Lakota. It's hard not to be inspired, do you know what I mean? By a place with such rich history, and you know there's going to be history, is going to continue to be made there for a long time.
Here I am.
I look at this job, the scene that we're in and the sort of fun element of it. It is the most fun job in the world. I didn't get into it. I didn't start going to raves and getting on it and, you know, partying to be serious. It's not a serious thing. And the first forms of dance music weren't serious. They were about party and vibes and everyone, like, I hate that word vibes, but party and people coming together and like just experiencing like moments together. Do you know what I mean? And it seems to me now, in certain factions, it's way too serious. And you're almost frowned upon if you're having fun. And I say that's probably the wrong way to look at it, but it's almost like, look at him having fun over there. It's kind of a bit taboo. I think me and a few of the English guys, like Seth, sorry, he's not English, but with Seth and with Jack Master and Scream and people like that, we all, it's a laugh. It's a laugh. We're getting somehow, so in some twist of amazing fate, we've basically somehow managed to land on this thing where we're getting paid to do the thing that we've dreamt of since we were little kids. And like, I don't know why you wouldn't want to do that with that smile on your face. I just think it's the most fun. I'm a very lucky boy and I treat it as a fun every single day. Despite it is essentially fun, I take it super, super seriously. I work pretty hard. I've done other jobs. You know, I've worked on building sites and in recruitment offices and all kinds of stuff. And I think this is as hard work as any of those. Yes, it's more fun and yes, it's more rewarding. But at the end of the day, it is really hard work. And I take it super seriously in the sense that it's very hard to become recognized, but it's very, very easy to be forgotten. You see some people that were massive heroes of mine and they're nowhere to be seen now. And it's sad, but it's like, if you don't work at it and you don't play the game the right way, I don't like to talk about it as a game, but it is essentially, everything's a game in a certain way. And if you don't play the game the right way, then you get left behind. So you have to take it seriously, the work side of it, you have to take it seriously, but the rest of it, once the work's done, the fun begins. Let's go dancing. Having to make music nowadays to sort of sustain a career, it's a bugbear in a certain way, because I've obviously grown up in a time where you didn't have to do that. The producers were producers and DJs were DJs. There's loads of people that made records, but you would never see them performing in a nightclub. And then there's loads of DJs that you would never see them making records, do you know what I mean? And it was like you could almost do one or the other, whereas now there's only very, very few like that I can think of. Jack Master, Ben UFO, Heidi, that Jobser, those kind of guys who don't really make records but are wicked DJs, and they've managed to sort of carve a career out, not just carve, smash the fuck out of it. I always say this, I get paid to make music and travel, and I DJ for free. And that's the way I look at my job. I DJ for free. The DJing's like the payoff at the end of it, but the making music is kind of a distraction. You know, I could be spending time with my family, but I have to go and be in the studio to make music, to continue my career, to further my career. So yeah, I get paid to travel and make music, but I DJ for fun, DJ for free. I wanna go dancing with you all night dancing. Let's go.